Simon & Schuster Audio presents A Call to Action, Women, Religion, Violence, and Power by Jimmy Carter. Read by the author.
To Karen Ryan and the countless women and girls whose abuse and deprivation she strives to alleviate. Introduction. All the elements in this book concerning prejudice, discrimination, war, violence, distorted interpretations of religious texts, physical and mental abuse, poverty, and disease fall disproportionately on women and girls. I saw the ravages of racial prejudice as I grew up in the Deep South, when for a century, the U.S. Supreme Court and all other political and social authorities accepted the premise that black people were, in some basic ways, inferior to white people. Even those in the dominant class who disagreed with this presumption remained relatively quiet and enjoyed the benefits of the prevailing system. Carefully selected holy scriptures were quoted to justify this discrimination in the name of God. There is a similar system of discrimination, extending far beyond a small geographical region to the entire globe. It touches every nation, perpetuating and expanding the trafficking in human slaves, body mutilation, and even legitimized murder on a massive scale. This system is based on the presumption that men and boys are superior to women and girls, and it is supported by some male religious leaders who distort the Holy Bible, the Quran, and other sacred texts to perpetuate their claim that females are, in some basic ways, inferior to them, unqualified to serve God on equal terms. Many men disagree but remain quiet in order to enjoy the benefits of their dominant status. This false premise provides a justification for sexual discrimination in almost every realm of secular and religious life. Some men even cite this premise to justify physical punishment of women and girls. Another factor contributing to the abuse of women and girls is an acceptance of violence, from an unwarranted armed combat to excessive and biased punishment for those who violate the law. In too many cases, we use violence as a first rather than a last resort, so that even deadly violence has become commonplace. My own experiences and the testimony of courageous women from all regions and all major religions have made it clear to me that as a result of these two factors, there is a pervasive denial of equal rights to women, more than half of all human beings, and this discrimination results in tangible harm to all of us, male and female. My wife, Rosalind, and I have visited about 145 countries, and the nonprofit organization we founded, the Carter Center, has had active projects in more than half of them. We've had opportunities in recent years to interact directly among the people, often in remote villages, in the jungles and deserts. We have learned a lot about their personal affairs, particularly that financial inequality has been growing more rapidly with each passing decade. This is true both between rich and poor countries and among citizens within them. In fact, the disparity in net worth and income in the United States has greatly increased since my time in the White House. By 2007, the income of the middle 60% of Americans had increased at a rate twice as high as that of the bottom 20%, and the rate of increase for the top 1% was over 15 times higher, primarily because of the undue influence of wealthy people who invest in elections and later buy greater benefits for themselves in Washington and in state capitals. As the conservative columnist George Will writes, and I quote, "Big government inevitably drives an upward distribution of wealth to those whose wealth, confidence, and sophistication enable them to manipulate government," unquote. Yet although economic disparity is a great and growing problem, I have become convinced that the most serious and unaddressed worldwide challenge is the deprivation and abuse of women and girls, largely caused by a false interpretation of carefully selected religious texts and a growing tolerance of violence and warfare. Unfortunately, following the example set during my lifetime by the United States. In addition to the unconscionable human suffering, almost embarrassing to acknowledge, there's a devastating effect on economic prosperity caused by the loss of contributions of at least half the human beings on Earth. This is not just a women's issue. It is not confined to the poorest countries. It affects us all. After focusing for a few years on the problem of gender discrimination through our human rights program at the Carter Center, I began to speak out more forcefully about it. Because of this, I was asked to address the Parliament of the World's Religions, an audience of several thousand who assembled in Australia in December 2009, about the vital role of religion in providing a foundation for countering the global scourge of gender abuse. My remarks represented the personal views of a Christian layman, a Bible teacher for more than 70 years, a former political leader. I reminded the audience that in dealing with each other, we are guided by international agreements as well as our own moral values, most often derived from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Bible, the Quran, and other cherished texts that proclaim a commitment to justice and mercy, equality of treatment between men and women, and a duty to alleviate suffering. However, some selected scriptures are interpreted almost exclusively by powerful male leaders within the Christian, Jewish, Muslim, Hindu, Buddhist, and other faiths to proclaim the lower status of women and girls. This claim that women are inferior before God spreads to the secular world to justify gross and sustained acts of discrimination and violence against them. This includes unpunished rape and other sexual abuse, infanticide of newborn girls and abortion of female fetuses, a worldwide trafficking in women and girls, and so-called honor killings of innocent women who are raped, as well as the less violent but harmful practices of lower pay and fewer promotions for women and greater political advantages for men. I mentioned some notable achievements of women despite these handicaps and described struggles within my own religious faith. I called on believers, whether Protestant, Catholic, Coptic, Jew, Muslim, Buddhist, Hindu, or tribal, to study these violations of our basic moral values and to take corrective action. Zaina Anwar, founder of Sisters in Islam in Malaysia, wrote, and I quote, "No matter what our faith may be, it is impossible to imagine a God who is unjust," unquote. I'm about to outline how I learned more and more about these issues as a child, a submarine officer, a farmer, and a church leader during the civil rights struggle, as a governor and a president, as a college professor, and in the global work of the Carter Center. During the 9 decades of my life, I have become increasingly aware of and concerned about the immense number of and largely ignored gender-based crimes. There are reasons for hope that some of these abuses can be ended when they become better known and understood. I hope that this book will help to expose these violations to a broader audience and marshal a more concerted effort to address this profound problem. I will explore the links between religion-based assertions of male dominance over women, as well as the ways that our culture of violence contributes to the denial of women's rights. I maintain that male dominance over women is a form of oppression that often leads to violence. We cannot make progress in advancing women's rights if we do not examine these two underlying factors that contribute to the abuse of women. In August 2013, I joined civil rights leaders and two other American presidents at the Lincoln Memorial to commemorate the 50th anniversary of Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream speech, delivered there in 1963. As I looked out at the crowd and thought about the book I was writing, my thoughts turned to a different speech that King made in New York City 4 years later about America's war in Vietnam, in which my oldest son was serving. King asserted, and I quote, "I knew that I could never again raise my voice against the violence of the oppressed in the ghettos without having first spoken clearly to the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today, my own government," unquote. King went on to ask that we Americans broaden our view to look at human freedom as inextricably linked with our commitment to peace and nonviolence. Using this same logic, it is not possible to address the rights of women, the human and civil rights struggle of our time, without looking at factors that encourage the acceptance of violence in our society, violence that inevitably affects women disproportionately. The problem is not only militarism in foreign policy, but also the resort to lethal violence and excessive deprivation of freedom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.